encuentro global con la recuperación
contra mundial en la empresa de la
fotografía. Tampoco son muy importantes.
Global Just Recovery Gathering.
Thank you so, so much for joining in this conversation on ending the finance of the fossil fuel industry with the monies of the peoples of America and also just around the globe. And so that's the whole point of today is talking about how we can work together in various forms, labor, to grassroots, to our local governments, to our federal governments, our national governments, to ending this. I wanted to, one, just give you all a quick opportunity to introduce yourselves and share with our viewers a little bit about your background. And I'm going to start with our friend Bill, and then I'll and Bill, then you can pass it to everyone.
Tracy, let me just say, first of all, many, many thanks for convening us. I've had a long time, too long a time maybe, to work on climate change, having written the first book about it back in the late 1980s, and gone on to help found 350.org and do a lot of other organizing over the years. And I'm particularly interested at the moment in these questions around money and finance and whether or not we can somehow head off the kind of suicide pact that the world's economic system seems to be engaged in right at the moment. So I think the questions couldn't be more timely. And I will pass it over to my old friend, Sharan, who I'm really glad always to get to see.
So this is the time. We've actually been saying now for almost a decade that all companies have to transition. It must be a just transition. And that includes the big fossil fuel companies. If they don't transition to renewables, then in fact, they will eventually see themselves out of business. The problem with that strategy today is that the time is now much more urgent, or the timeline is much more urgent. And we are still seeing the resistance to actually transitioning out of fossil fuels. Some of these major fossil fuel companies have the platform, they have the technology, they have the finance capacity, and they're backed by big shareholders to actually transition to renewables. And if that transition has, you know, some timelines for gas along the way, if it has some transition towards hydrogen, all of that's fine. But we need a transparent plan that shows when we can expect carbon neutrality, and for workers, how they're going to protect jobs, and indeed where they can't protect jobs, what are the just transition measures that will make it possible? And they're very simple. It's actually about making sure that older workers have secure pensions. If indeed the choice is early retirement, there's a bridge to secure pensions. For younger workers, that there is indeed income support for reskilling, with support for that training, and of course, redeployment support. And there's responsibility for community renewal. So we don't leave stranded assets, we don't leave stranded people, and we don't leave their communities stranded. So the time is now, and it's urgent. And finance is shifting. So if these companies aren't shifting, frankly, jobs and communities are even more at risk.
So I'm Damon Drummer at New Consensus, and I completely agree with Sharan. You know, I would add to that there is an economic, I can't even call it an ideology right now, this hostility to government, our government, the instrument of the people playing an active role in facilitating and at times powering this transition. That ideology has transferred into a dogma where there is active resistance to anything that sounds like our governments at every level would be in some way involved and in some cases leading this transition. And so we're talking about financial regulation, you know, outlawing and monitoring and regulating the amount of investment that can go to fossil fuel, right? Those aren't assets, as Bill has famously said. Those are, you know, that oil, you know, oil deposits and these you know, these aren't assets on the balance sheets of BP. This isn't an asset. This is death and destruction and must be accounted for as such. And so that requires regulation. That requires limiting what we can and cannot do with investor money, right? And this really, for some reason, triggers a lot of reflexive, you know, responses where folks think we're being, you know, you know, trying to eliminate the entire private sector. And so I've been fascinated at the hostility of like clear, sensible, common sense solutions for folks who are afraid of government playing an active role in our society. We know what that's all about.
I'm just going to jump in. So, hey, everyone, I am Mitzi Jonelle Tan. I am a climate justice activist from the Philippines. I organize with Youth Advocates for Climate Action Philippines, which is a long name, but basically we're the Fridays for Future of the Philippines. And I also organize with Fridays for Future International. As many of you guys probably know, but maybe our audience doesn't, the Philippines is one of the most vulnerable countries to the climate crisis. We are hit by typhoon after typhoon, year after year. Our average is 20. The three strongest storm landfalls in recorded history all happened in the Philippines. And I basically just grew up with the typhoons like right outside my door. Like I would have to spend weeks without electricity, having to do homework by the candlelight. And then I'm seeing that all these world leaders, they're waving around net zero like a magic wand, as Sharan mentioned earlier, that as if this is the solution. But right here, we have a solution. We have to phase out from the fossil fuel industry. We have to end the support for them financially, but we're not doing that. And it doesn't make sense to me as someone who is seeing the climate crisis happening before her very eyes, someone who really understands that the climate crisis is a life and death situation, that we still continue to fund this very thing, this very energy system that is leading us to a path of destruction. And I actually graduated from university with a degree of mathematics. And I remember thinking, oh, after I do this, I'm gonna go into climate activism and I never have to look at graphs and Excel sheets and numbers again. I can just, you know, organize and be cool. And then here I am finding that the finance classes that I took in mathematics would be actually be very helpful here. Not necessarily that I enjoy it, but you know, it's very helpful in this type of activism. And really, that's why it's so important that we don't just see numbers and we don't just see figures, as I think Bill or Damon already mentioned. These are actual people being impacted by the lives of, by the decisions, by one simple signature on a paper, by one simple enter on a tab, on a spreadsheet. That's a life that the fossil fuel industry is literally killing, and not just in the future, not just because of the climate crisis, but today with air pollution, with displacement of farmers and fishing communities. This is something that plenty of the coal plants here actually do. And who's funding the coal plants here? Standard Chartered Bank, a bank in the UK, banks from the global north. So we're really seeing that it is a global problem, and we need to put pressure, especially on the countries that are most responsible for the climate crisis.
Thank you all for very, very insightful and moving openers. I could probably just let you all just talk and everyone would enjoy it. But since I'm here, I thought I'll jump in. I want to start with Damon and ask you, how does ending fossil fuel finance relate to building a better world?
I mean, it's everything, right? I mean, I think it's one thing to talk about a transition, but if we're putting, if we're adding fuel to the fire, which is finance, as Mitzi mentioned, that's just more stuff that we need to transition off of. And so it comes down to, and I want to be very clear here, you know, I remember Mitzi, and it's fascinating, you have a background in finance and accounting and know all the spreadsheets and stuff. I'm re-embracing the the boring stuff that I avoided studying accounting in college and did like statistics instead. Now I'm like, ah, I got to learn accounting because this stuff really matters, right? But anyway, I was being told in early 2020 that, you know, we shouldn't really be thinking about the Federal Reserve System, which is not just America's kind of public bank. It creates our money. It also regulates banks and says what they can and cannot do along with OCC and other regulators. But I was being told in late 2019, early 2020, that, you know, the Federal Reserve System likes to go slow and be measured and moderate, and don't really think about the Federal Reserve as a vector of influence for transitioning off of fossil fuels. And then COVID happened, and we literally saw the Federal Reserve System, and I'm quoting a news reporter on Bloomberg, say the Federal Reserve System literally threw the kitchen sink times infinity at the financial fallout from the COVID crisis. Right? Kitchen sink times infinity for Wall Street, basically nothing for many, many months. And I would say even now, a year later, basically nothing for Main Street, right? And so what we're seeing here is that, yes, we have tools in our toolkit that can control, not just create money, but can control and govern the flows of capital and money in our economy. And we have to use those tools to divert and redirect not just public capital, but private capital away from the stuff that's killing us and to the things that we need. And again, just saying that, you know, a year and a half ago was radical and revolutionary. But now, and I'm wrapping up here, we see that it is entirely possible. And so that's it's interesting to see how this is working out here. So again, we have the tools to eliminate the funding of fossil fuels, fiscal policy and monetary and governance and regulation.
Well, there's no doubt that if you just pulled out the finance today and there was no plan for transition, no alternate investment plans from government or the private sector in those communities, then that would be devastating. But that's why we support just transition, so that there is, in fact, a plan that people can see and trust, that they have hope. Hope is the centre of it, of a secure future for themselves and their children. And then all our polling is the same as yours. People know we have to face the climate emergency. People want their governments to act. And I was interested to look indeed at the public finances, because I think private finances will increasingly, and we're seeing it now in fossil fuels, will shift as they start to see the risk from their own shareholders' demands, but also the capital return risk. But if you think about public money, 70% of emissions are not taxed at all, not taxed at all. $500 billion goes to public subsidies on fossil fuels, while only $300 billion goes to renewables. And of course, ODA, to help with the developed economies where we could be sharing technology, transitioning all economies, making sure that everybody is indeed part of a more sustainable and resilient future, then it is, you know, less than 5% of any kind of ODA. And I think it's actually far less than that. So we need to see all of this ramped up in action. Renewables should be at the forefront of people's minds, whether it's government or private investors, but also making sure that those fossil fuel companies transition. And that's got to be part and parcel exactly of the governance regulation framework that you just laid out. There's a big question in my mind, though, about how we actually generate that kind of leadership. There are governments in the Powering Past Coal Alliance that are making a difference. And indeed, Antonio Guterres said to them just 2 weeks ago that they actually need to make sure just transition measures for people's confidence are in place. But I don't see the same push on oil and gas. Even if anything, there's a renewed set of demands with the kind of almost false prophets beyond a transition period of abatement for gas and indeed transition into hydrogen that's not green hydrogen. Now, are these part of some transition? Yes. But for how long? What's the time frame? What's the promise for people and investors of what happens then?
I think that people who are watching this will really want to hear your vision on how we protect the workers, right? So these are people with great paying union jobs. Some of them probably make six figures or more. Obviously, it's incredibly dangerous, but working renewables to a certain extent doesn't present those same danger issues, health issues.
You're absolutely right, Tracy. You can't convince people that a transition plan is a job in the energy industry, but in renewables when it's paid less than half the salary, when there are no equivalent benefits. However, we're seeing some very, very good agreements, not enough, but some emerge now. And in the US, Ørsted, a Danish wind company, is in fact a very good example. They've done, they have an MOU with the building trades that's been supported by ourselves through the ITSC's Just Transition Centre, indeed the AFL, and groups like the New York Labour Council have a terrific approach to leadership on climate and jobs. And they're good agreements because they go to dealing with this question of union jobs, prevailing wage rates, a rights-based social dialogue, which is really severely lacking in the US, and, of course, respecting, the representation of workers and collective bargaining. That's the kind of agreements we want.
Mitzi, I would love for you to share a little bit more what you touched on as a, you know, a youth activist in the global South. And what does ending fossil fuel finance mean to you where you are?
Ending fossil fuel finance means basically what Sharan just left with, prioritizing people and planet over profit. And I feel like for countries like the Philippines, it is so clear to us why this should be something that's happening. And of course, with the consideration of our workers and our fishing communities, our farmers, everyone, really development cannot leave anyone behind. That is what climate justice is, making sure that those most marginalized, those most impacted are with us and leading the way into our just transition, leading our way to a better world. Because what world will we have if those who are providing our food, those who are the backbones of our society, aren't with us, right? And so ending the fossil fuel industry is required, like ending the finance, especially the fossil fuel industry, is required to have a better world. We cannot develop with this rotten industry that is literally killing us today. Like, for an example, Standard Chartered Bank, which is the bank that Fridays for Future is focusing on right now, they've poured at least $24 billion in the fossil fuel industry since the Paris Agreement was signed. And just today, I think, since the Paris Agreement was signed, there's a study that was released that the world's 60 biggest banks have poured over $3.8 trillion into fossil fuels. I can't even imagine that number. And I'm a mathematician. Like, imagine all those zeros. Like, all that money into something that we know is bad for us. It doesn't make sense. And I don't understand why world leaders, why the public scene and the private sector also don't see it the same way when it's so clear to us that this is life and death. I've already said that, and I will keep saying it because it's as simple as that. We have to start prioritizing people's lives. And we can't keep doing that if we keep thinking of 5% reduction of coal development, blah, blah, still continuing coal developers. Oh, we're here, we're doing whatever we can. We're doing this, we're consulting with people. Like, we don't need that. Right now, we need action. We need action today. We need to start, we should have started the just transition already. And there is no excuse, especially for countries in the global north, to not start the just transition. Workers in the global north have also been leading the way. And I've talked to a few workers, working unions internationally, and they're also already on board for the transition. So what is keeping you? Like, really, it's just greed and profit, and I would say selfishness. Because if you knew what we experienced year after year after year, last year I couldn't go home because the floods reached 12 meters or 40 feet high. I had to stay in someone else's place and not know if my house was consumed by the floods, if my mom was still okay, if she was stranded on a rooftop. This is what we're dealing with because of the fossil fuel industry. And we're saying enough. We have to cut the lifeline of the fossil fuel industry and really just begin our just transition, because the climate crisis isn't 10 years from now. It's already here today. And I like to use this analogy a lot. I feel like it's because adults haven't been in school for a long time, so they don't understand the concept of a deadline anymore. But, you know, if someone is like me who has been in, like, I know when a professor tells me that there's a deadline, I have to reach that deadline. And if it's a huge homework, I can't start it the night before, otherwise I'm going to crash and fail. And this is a huge homework. We should have done it. We have our research. We have everything. We just need to start doing things. Why haven't we? This is a huge homework. We can't start when runaway climate change is right in front of our faces. It'll be too late. We will fail. And it's not just a failing grade here. It is failing society. So why haven't we started?
Bill, if you had Mitzi in class, I know you'd be incredibly happy. But what would you share with her and her classmates on what the theory of change is behind ending fossil fuel financing?
Well, very good question, Tracy. And of course, it's wonderful to get to see Mitzi today. It really brings to my mind all these questions that she's raising about time and deadlines, because of course I've known so many of the people who've worked out of the Philippines over the decades on this question, old friends like Yeb Sano or Liddy Nakpil, or just, you know, great heroes, and the same in every country and in every state in the union. We're talking with them and thinking about all the people out of Illinois over the years who've led this fight, and all the, you know, if we had 50 years to solve this problem, we'd be okay. You know, we're shifting the zeitgeist, we're moving in the right direction. Overt climate denial got on the plane with Trump to Florida and it's not coming back, you know, on and on. So we're making progress. The problem is, we're not making progress anywhere near fast enough, because our enemy here in the end is physics, and physics is implacable. It just does what it does, and we have to meet its terms. And the scientists have told us what its terms are. I mean, they've given us the deadline that Mitzi's talking about. They've said if by 2030 we haven't had a fundamental transformation of our energy systems, that is cutting emissions in half, by 2030, which is 9 years away, then the chances of meeting the targets that we set in Paris are nil. So what does that mean? That means that the financial institutions, the big banks and asset managers that are pumping money still into the fossil fuel industry are cooperating in a plan to subvert everything that we know about the science of climate change. They're betting on the end of the world and trying to make money on that bet. Now, people are rising up against it. As you know, some of us have worked for a decade on this fossil fuel divestment campaign, which has become the largest anti-corporate campaign in history. We're at about $15 trillion. Devin, we're expecting good news from just north of you in Ann Arbor today, so keep your eyes open. But that divestment campaign now is morphing into a real effort to go after the financiers. You know, the last place I went before lockdown started last year was to jail in D.C. Because a few of us, Reverend Yearwood from the Hip Hop Caucus, and I and a few others were arrested in the lobby of the Chase Bank nearest the nation's capital, because Chase Bank is the world's largest funder of fossil fuels. They've put $250 billion into the fossil fuel industry since the Paris Climate Accords. They didn't need Donald Trump to subvert and sabotage them. They were willing to do it themselves. And that's insane. I mean, it's literally insane because, even if all you cared about in the world was money, well, you know, there's not going to be any money once everybody's flooded out and burned out and everything else. I mean, the short-termism of it all is just incredible. And you know, we're not here to figure out whether, I guess today, whether, you know, capitalism is what we, you know, but I got to say, you know, at the moment, capitalism, at least the way it's practiced on Wall Street, is raising the temperature of the planet. It's melting the ice in the Arctic. It is undermining everything that's the basis of any kind of working economy or civilization. So at some level, I don't get it. I mean, I really don't get it. These guys are supposed to be smart. They're supposed to be analyzing everything all the time. They're supposed to have spreadsheets that, you know, to the end of the earth and, you know, on and on and on. But what the hell? I mean, so it is time now for people to double and triple this pressure on these guys. And if we do, then some good will come of it. You know, we got to pressure our political systems all the time, and that's really important. And we're making some progress in Washington. But Washington moves slowly at best, like most political capitals. And Washington doesn't run the world anymore, for mostly better, you know. Wall Street, for better or for worse, mostly for worse, still kind of does run the world. And the one thing to be said for it is it moves fast. If something happens at Chase Bank or BlackRock or something, it's reflected in every stock market in the world in a matter of hours. So please, people, keep this push on. Go after these guys every way you can. They're vulnerable, and it's within the realm of possibility that they will shift because we can put enough pressure on them. They're not like Exxon. Chase Bank isn't. You know, Exxon's going to fight to the last bridge. It only knows how to do one thing: dig stuff up and burn it. But Chase Bank makes plenty of money off fossil fuels, but it's only 5 or 6% of their business. They've got other things they can do too. So we've got to make them close that part of the deal book, and give the planet some kind of fighting chance here.
You know, because, you know, my focus and at New Consensus, we focus a lot on, you know, public finance, public investments, things like that. But to Bill's point, when the people are pushing private capital away from fossil fuels, that not only takes money out of the pipeline, so to speak, for fossil fuels, but it creates an environment for people in government to follow, right? And see that it's okay to do these things, and it's okay to do these regulations, right? Because the banks and these other investors are already moving away because y'all have pushed them away. So there's two things being accomplished there, right? There's a systemic concern that's being addressed there. It opens a channel for timid folks in government, right, who need to be replaced, but it opens a channel for timid folks in government to go ahead and follow your leadership, right? And having that vector of impact is direly important and critical. But to speak to the, you know, the Green New Deal and FDR and the New Deal, the public imagination around the New Deal era actually not only includes all the great, you know, government innovation that happened in the New Deal per se, but it also includes the World War II mobilization, right? And so that was when the U.S. government spent tons of public money to build an entire industry. Unfortunately, it was an industry for death, but it built an entire industry and retooled America's productive capacity to help fight fascism abroad, right? The question is, can we retool America's productive capacity, right? I'm talking about domestically, the US here from my perspective, can we retool America's productive capacity to wean ourselves off of fossil fuels and create a sustainable economy? The answer is yes. The answer is yes, but what we're seeing is there is an economic dogma that has constrained our ability to even imagine that possibility. Look at what's happening with COVID, right? We think that, intellectual property overrides the ability for human beings to move around or to be vaccinated. That is the throttle. Don't be fooled, y'all. Intellectual property rights are the throttle right now for us getting our vaccines. I can say that over and over again, but ad nauseum. That's the real choke point there. And to be clear, don't be fooled about this either. The US government at least has the power to take that intellectual property for the public benefit. So the reality is that our government, the instrument of we the people, is incredibly powerful. And so again, we have to push it, seize control over it, and make it work for us. So this idea of government being inefficient, the way they try to defund the post office and make it ineffective. I just started getting mail on the same day yesterday. You know, I got mail from January, on Monday, right? Wild stuff, right? But that's deliberate. That is absolutely deliberate. So this idea of, getting folks to see government as ineffective, inefficient, slow, is deliberate. Our government is powerful. It is our instrument of we the people, and it can do incredible things when we lead it to do those incredible things. Again, New Deal, World War II mobilization, that era that created prosperity for certain people in America, we have a blueprint for what is possible and things that haven't been tried before for moving to a sustainable economy and nations of the North leading and doing our part to correct the harms that we have put onto this planet from the past. So we have an obligation to move a lot faster and to be aggressive and bold in this time. We owe it to our brothers and sisters and all others across the world, particularly because we led the way on causing this harm.
Like converting all of that into grassroots activism, what vision can you share with folks on how to move people to change their minds on the ways our government works, change minds on these fundamental misbeliefs that we are not empowered to affect change?
Especially for the youth, I think it's a lot about showing people that it's okay to hope. Hope for something better. Hope for something that we deserve. A better world shouldn't be radical. The things we're asking, the things where we're saying that we want a just transition, we want a future that where no one is left behind, a future where there's development for all, a zero, we want a future where we can all just live. And people will say that this is unrealistic. People will say that this is radical, but it's not. Why are we compromising on our lives? Again, I will keep going back to that point. People are already dying and suffering because of the climate crisis, and that's only going to get worse. This is a life and death situation. So we need to get imaginative. We need to get creative, and we need to break free from what we've already, what's being taught to us systemically, essentially. Like, there are so many movies where I talk to my friend about this a lot, where it's so much easier for movies to show the end of the world than the end of our current system. Like, we have so many movies about zombie apocalypse. Why was there a zombie apocalypse? Because there's a health pandemic outbreak because of some scientists doing something for their profit. Or we've had a few climate change and disaster movies, and it's always just to the end of the world. Why can't we imagine something beyond the current profit-oriented, wasteful, greedy system that we have? We've already seen that this system isn't working for us. That the COVID-19 pandemic has shown us that our systems, a lot of our systems across the world, are not capable of handling a crisis. It won't be capable of handling the climate crisis either. So we have to allow ourselves to hope. We have to allow ourselves to dream of a better future and fight for that dream relentlessly, with passion, with no fear. And I'm not gonna lie and say that I'm a fearless activist and I'm always brave. It's scary to have the typhoons banging on your doors, and also the risk of having police bang on your doors, with the Philippines being one of the most dangerous countries in the world for defenders and activists. But we know that the risks that we're facing now is nothing like the risk of the climate crisis once runaway climate change starts. And so we have to do this from a place of love, from a place that's sustainable, from a place that goes back always to the people, always to the ones who are most marginalized. We can, the youth, as much as we'd like to think that we can do this alone, we can't do this alone. We need everyone on board. We need especially those who are most marginalized. And we need to listen to our farmers, our fishing communities, our workers, our indigenous peoples. We need a multi-sectoral movement because everyone is at risk here, not just the future of the youth, but the future of the human species. This is literally life and death, and we have to keep going, and we have to really believe that a better world is possible.
What is your greatest hope? I'm inspired by what Mitzi just shared. Feel free to add on to what you said, Mitzi, Bill, Damon. What's your greatest hope in this fight against climate change?
For me, what gives me hope is knowing that I have a friend in every continent, well, except Antarctica. Not yet. We'll find someone there. Fighting for the same thing as I am. That is mind-blowing to me. This is literally a global movement, and we are getting more and more connected, and we are getting more and more intersectional. That gives me so much hope. With so many people on board fighting for climate justice and a better world, how is victory not possible? I feel like it is inevitable. We will get there. That's what gives me hope. And what I'm hoping for, again, is the chance for a better future, for a sustainable future, for a safe society.
I even know some people in Antarctica who are working on this. So, look, one of my hopes is all the work that we're doing is starting to pay off. 10 years ago, Exxon was the biggest company in the world. Now it's not even the biggest energy company in the world. Next Era Energy, a Florida-based renewables company, passed them in market cap last year. So they're getting weaker. They're not going away, but every dollar they lose is that makes them that much politically weaker and that much less able to wreck policy initiatives like the ones that Devon people are working on all the time. There's days when I get a little despairing and all I can, you know, the only thing that keeps me going is how much trouble can we cause the bad guys? And we're causing them lots of trouble, so that's good.
My hope, kind of riffing off of Mitzi's point of why is existence and the right to live radical, is that everything that we're talking about is common sense. And I don't think common sense ever goes out of fashion. It might not be in power, but damn it, we got common sense. And I know that might not be, it's not sexy, but this is just super, it's just common sense. And that gives me a lot of hope. We're right. And the world and the people in power will catch up, or we replace them. And that's all happening at the same time. And it's wonderful to be part of this growing movement.
In the theme of hope and visioning, where do you all see the climate movement moving, and how will it be moving?
I mean, young people are completely organized and on board and working hard. Now we need to get old people fully engaged here. There's so many of them, and so much of the world's money is in their bank accounts that they're a kind of political and financial block to change. And so when we think about diversity, let's make sure we're thinking about it in lots of dimensions and calling on, we need Mitzi's crew calling out to their grandparents and making sure that they're fully engaged, because they're about to be people who leave this world in worse shape than they found it. And that's not a good legacy.
Right, right. So, you know, I was going to jump in on this question first, because I feel like I am a relative newcomer to the climate movement, because my focus was economics. I was doing local organizing against, like in Chicago, trying to create opportunities with young people and communities, community development, it's a whole mess, and just really fighting at that level. And I came to see that the same dogmas and structures I was struggling against just having a right of having a decent life and be able to make a living for one's family in a safe community, that the same blocks that I was up against, undoing those blocks opens the door and is the key indeed to solving the climate crisis, right? To solving poverty and all the other issues. And so I see a diversity in approach and perspective. What I love is that we're in a moment now where people are seeing the climate space as something they should be thinking about and adding to their particular fight, whether it be worker rights, whether it be racial and economic justice and what have you. And so it's been beautiful to be, you know, I would say I was concerned about climate, but it was not the thing that I woke up and thought about every day. And now I think about climate in the context of the way to build a sustainable economy is the way to build a fair and just and racially inclusive economy as well. And so that combination and having conversations with folks who are getting their head around what climate means for their fight and how this is all connected, right? That has been something that I've been very excited to be a part of and to see happening, because I got pulled into this in that way where it's a big fight. And I think everybody has a stake. And I'll add also, you know, people who are accountants, seeing that they have a role to play, you know, and all the other things that you can do. Everybody has a stake in this fight. And I love that.
At this point, I don't think the climate movement is shifting. To say it like that is to take away from the organizers who are pushing the climate movement to become more intersectional, to become more diverse, to become a truly climate justice fight. So as Damon said, climate justice means making sure that everyone's struggles are tied together, because the climate crisis is the thing that will affect everyone, and not proportionally. Those who are already impacted by the existing socioeconomic crises of the world are the ones who are also most impacted by the climate crisis. And that's why our view of everything has to be very intersectional.
You know, we've all got to be in this together, and people on the planet with a mentality around shared prosperity absolutely have to be at the center of our plans for recovery. And I'll leave you with one last statistic. There's been about $14 trillion spent already in supporting business, workers, health, et cetera. So expanding the social contract through the pandemic. How much of it's been spent on actually making sure that the recovery is going to be indeed a sustainable recovery is like this much. So we've got a lot of work to do to build, even as we deal with the last of the pandemic issues, and they're serious, we also need to look at how we build recovery and resilience. For us, that's a new social contract, but all those jobs have to be climate-friendly jobs, and we're not going to get it if governments aren't actually looking at the three things that Damon actually raised. One is, what's their contribution? The second is, what's their legislative frame? And the third is, how do you manage governance in the interests of people and planet?
I am just standing in gratitude for getting to spend some time with you all. Thank you so much. And I hope I get to see you again somewhere out here in the internet universe, but more especially, I hope that we will all be able to get to see each other, our family and friends, in person. And so wishing you all continued good health to you and your families. Stay safe, stay hydrated. And this is Global Just Recovery 350, sending out love and peace, and thanking you all. And please have a wonderful day.
Global Just Recovery Gathering.